Yeah, don't keep talking about it.
You know what Cody has seen? Actually, you know what neither of you guys have seen?
What?
A lot of things.
Comic books I just bought today.
Oh, that too.
Yeah. I bought, first off, but we've been talking about this one for a little bit, but I bought the Batman One Bad Day, the Riddler.
Ooh, I need to pick that up.
But I didn't buy the Tom King cover. I bought the Jim Lee cover.
Ooh, is that Riddler on the cover, like sitting there like...
Yeah, it's Riddler, that's the Batman right here.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and apparently they're doing one per villain. It'll be like next month is Two-Face, the one after that is like Penguin, shit like that.
Oh, it's a one-shot.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they're all one-shots. Okay. Then I bought this comic, which I thought looked pretty cool, and it actually is by our boy Tom King. It's Supergirl, Woman of Tomorrow.
Ew. Is that the first issue, or it's like a paperback? It's
the entire paperback, yeah.
Oh, nice.
It looks sick, honestly. The art looks trippy as fuck.
Let me know how that one is.
Yeah, definitely. Since we know you hate female superheroes.
I love female superheroes.
Yeah, all right. If you got to say those words. I bought volume 2 of Something is Killing the Children by James Tinian, because volume 1 was pretty sick.
Ooh, okay. I need to still read volume 1.
See, I'm putting you on this new. I bought this random. It looks cool because it's old. I found it for like $5. It's a DC comic book, but it doesn't look like it has anything to do with superheroes because I was flipping through it. It's just a kid, but it's called Hard Time 50 to Life.
What? What is that?
This is what it says on the back. A high school shooting cost 4 students their lives and a 15-year-old Ethan Childs his future. Now Ethan's got 50 years of hard time to look forward to. The critic says, it's like Oz meets My So-Called Life.
That's insane.
Yeah.
What a combo. What a fucking combo.
And then because you've been talking about it, and sometimes people we interview talk about it, I decided to buy volume 1 of The Immortal Hulk.
Yes!
Gonna give it a go. If I don't like it, I'm not... And then Cody, this one I thought pertains to you when I read it. It's a... And I'm so excited for this one just because like TKO is fire. It's another TKO comic called Red Fork. Mm-hmm. And it's about an ex-con Noah McGlade returns to his coal mining hometown to find it blighted by opioid abuse and economic decline. But there's something even darker draining the very life from this town. And as Noah digs deeper, he unearths a dormant horror that threatens to consume what little he has left to live for. So pretty much all right. Logan County, West Virginia.
Hell yeah, dude. Yeah. Dude, so, yeah. I wish Logan's problems were actually a dormant horror and not just, not just what's really happening.
But yeah, those are my new comic buys for the week.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Nice. Those are some nice pickups, dude.
Yeah, man. You know how I do, bro. Got that quality shit.
Quality shit.
Hey, you guys know what today is?
What's today?
August 22nd.
Oh.
Which is, get ready for this. I didn't know this until like 5 minutes ago. This is coming straight down from Comics and Chronics headquarters.
HQ?
HQ. I think this is the first time we've got something for HQ. That's how serious it is.
Yeah.
Today is Tony Soprano's birthday.
Whoa, is it really?
Yeah. August 22nd is Tony Soprano's birthday.
No shit.
Nice.
We did not plan that whatsoever. No.
No, we did not. I didn't even know that until you just told me that right now.
Nice.
I got really? It from headquarters. Like, headquarters.
Dude, sometimes the universe unfolds as it should, you know?
Right? Nice.
Fuck yeah. That's awesome. Well, then in that case, what better way to finish out Sopranos Summer?
Yeah, this is it. This is our farewell.
This is it. Yeah, this is our farewell. It's been quite a journey, you guys.
The Sopranos, fare thee well to our fans.
Chow. Yeah.
This is our sign-off episode. We might never come back
after. That would be so on brand. The final episode of Comics and Chronic is a Sopranos episode.
Oh, man. Dude, yeah. Today, well, welcome to Comics and Chronic. Welcome to the finale of Sopranos Summer. I'm Jacob H. With me is Anthony Anacho, Cody Wallaka Cannon. And we're talking the series finale episode, season 6B, episode
9.
Made in America.
Yeah.
And this is the grand finale.
What a finale it was.
I'll be honest, and I've said this before, but when I first watched it in college, I was not a fan of it. It took literally like 6-7 years for me to even begin to entertain liking it. And now, now I like it.
what changed your mind? Because that's really interesting.
I think I was immature. I was literally a freshman in college. So I was like, what the fuck, man? That's lame. You know, like, just what did I know about creative artistic license and then or storytelling? And then now, you know, many people call me the David Chase of Comics and Chronics. So
Jake F. Chase.
Yeah, Jacob Chase. No, honestly, I just like, yeah, I think I like matured and I like talked about it with friends and family over the years. And I was like, I actually do like it. And then I started interpreting it because this is what I was going to ask. Well, and I'll have to ask it for later because I don't want to hop around too much. But it's about the end of the episode. So if you guys want to get into it.
Yeah, let's get into it.
Let's get into it.
We could go with whatever.
Well, I was going to, my next question was, Cody, when was the first time you saw the finale?
COVID.
Oh. Same.
2020.
Both saw it in COVID?
Yeah.
I saw mine in 2020, summer 2020. It was my big watch.
Nice. Well, I guess for me, it was 2021. So COVID, COVID's still here, I guess. But not pandemic, but like.
Yeah. Not for my people. Yeah,
now it's pussy COVID. Only weaklings die of it now. Like for the last three episodes, I've shat on people who commit suicide and now people who died of COVID.
Hell yeah, brother.
Soprano Summer, baby. It's very summer. Tony Soprano like of you.
Yeah, seriously. He doesn't give a fuck.
But did you like it right away, Cody? Was it something that...
I mean, I knew the ending.
Oh, before seeing it?
Yeah, I feel like it's hard if you know pop culture at all.
I agree.
You know the ending.
People have been talking about that ending since it came out.
Yeah.
That's true.
Like one of the most...
It was such a huge show. Yeah, you couldn't not talk
huge
about
show.
It.
Huge show. Also, like, one of the most controversial endings to a show, easily. Period.
Yeah, because when I remember hearing about it, all I remember was that people were pissed that it ends abruptly, and then I remember that Don't Stop Believing was a big part of it. Like, that's all I remembered. So, like, watching the show, knowing those details didn't change it for me. It was still so impactful.
Yeah, I mean, it was impactful for sure, but I knew it was coming, for me. I didn't know in what way, though. I didn't know, like,
time out. Do you mean specifically, like, you knew it was going to cut to black at the end?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah, but I didn't know everything leading up. I didn't know we were going to be losing Bobby and Syl the episode before. I didn't know that Phil was going to get murdered. I didn't know the state that it was going to leave the family. And
I mean, it paves the way for Meadowlands, the spinoff series.
Oh, absolutely.
To take the reins.
I definitely got some more ideas watching this episode because I forgot. You know what I didn't realize? I didn't realize the first time watching it that Meadow actually believed Tony when he would tell her he's not in the mafia. Think about it though. She says, I became a lawyer because I saw all the times the FBI were persecuting you. And a lot of times he's always like, oh, they always persecute the Italians. You know, they all saying this, this, and that.
I think honestly,
you're omitting a line that she says specifically. She said, if you can get carted off that easily by the federal government, imagine what it's like for minorities or other people.
Right. But
Tony's a white guy. If the federal system can fuck her, that's why she's, you know, volunteering volunteered at the Bronx, South Bronx Law Center, like to help minorities. I don't think she wasn't a sucker like that. She knew she's been in Tony's mafia. Also,
I think Anthony, if anything, that line was kind of almost like a me hee ha ha ha. You know what I mean? Like, this is kind of like, I'm who I am today. Like, maybe you would have had a pediatrician if you wouldn't have been a mobster. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Kind of like, I feel like, I feel like there's more intelligent. I don't feel like she was just like, you know what I mean? Because she's her father's daughter.
I don't think it makes her, I don't think it would make her stupid. It would just kind of be like her way of just processing it. If your dad's like the head of the mob, you know, like, I don't know. Like, I think you guys make more sense than that.
I don't think she was that naive. I think the episode where she takes him to visit colleges, she figures it out. She says, "Are you in the mob?" You know what I mean? When they're
right.
In the car.
And I do remember that scene very clearly.
She knows he's in the mafia. I don't think she meant it like that, what she said.
Yeah, I think she, it was kind of almost like a teasing jab. You know what I mean? That more than a, like, oh, I'm naive and I don't, or like willfully or not, I don't think she's that naive. You know what I mean?
True.
Facts, Meadow.
Do you think Meadow is, maybe this is jumping too far ahead. I'll save that question for later. I'll save it for later. Because I want to talk about, like, I feel like there's so many things that happen scene to scene, right? Like, the very first thing we see in this episode is, it looks like Tony is like
in a casket.
Laying down in a casket, right? Yep. You hear organ music
play. You even hear the organ music play and it ends up being the rock and roll song.
Right.
The Pink Floyd song, I think.
Right, exactly. But he was just sleeping. Yeah, there's just music playing. But the way, you know, it's just like...
Definitely, I agree with that. And I don't think I caught that when I first originally watched it either.
Mm.
Yeah, there is that scene. You also find out, like, just through, like, the great writing, there's a part where they're in the house in this episode. You know, they're playing cards or whatnot. And Benny Fazio says to Tony, "Hey, we're going to go visit Syl down the hospital if you want to come." And Tony's like, I got some shit to do. And he walks upstairs with his big gun. And Benny says, yesterday it was his gout. So you find out that, like, Tony's like mad unhealthy. Like, he has gout. Right. You know what I mean? Like, that's a little like detail they dropped for you.
Mm. Yeah, I didn't realize that either.
Yeah.
So it's like, even if he, like, I think this season, especially this end, kind of shows that he's on the decline. We see he has a gambling problem when he kind of has a hard time giving Hesh's money back.
Right.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, he's spending more money than he actually earns. Now we see that the war with Phil has kind of cost him financially, both in the way of Bobby and Syl. And, you know, their guys are getting squeezed.
The government's on his ass. He finds out he's probably going to get indicted.
You find out Carlo flipped.
Yep.
Who was Carlo?
Carlo was one of the captains. His son was one of the friends with AJ when they tortured that one kid in college.
He's also an older guy. He has gray hair.
Yeah, Carlo has gray hair.
Okay, I know who you're talking about, I think.
Yeah, Tony thinks he flipped, or he probably did flip because his son gets caught with drugs. His son got arrested
for ecstasy, for selling ecstasy.
Yep.
So he probably flipped. Well, then the lawyer says it's Carlo. And then he's like 80% chance you'll be indicted. Mm-hmm. And Tony's like all pissed. It's when they're eating the hamburger and he's smacking the ketchup bottle.
Yeah.
And the lawyer is like, trials are there to be won. And so it's like you wonder, like, if they do go to trial, is Tony going to win, you know?
Right. And it's all because of the gun he dropped when he was running away.
The gun he dropped coupled with like everything else. Carlos, whatever Carlos says, all the other, like, they've been building since season one a case on Tony Soprano, you know?
Right.
So they have probably a good amount on him to try him in, you know, court.
Right. So it's you bring up a lot of good points. Even if at the end of this episode, Tony isn't whacked, he doesn't have a bright future ahead of him. He's either going to get whacked, just like every mobster in the show. You either get whacked, you go to jail.
Yeah. And he says that.
Exactly.
But now I have a question for you. And I have a question and you have to answer it before you even read anything or saw David Chase's answer, which only came out this year. So I have a hard time counting that.
Wait, like David Chase has an answer about the finale?
I thought you said he did.
I remember
you told.
Oh, see, I didn't know that.
Somebody told a story where David Chase says, yes, he does get killed.
Yeah. Cody, you said that?
Oh, Cody, you said that?
Yep.
Okay. Is that, I've never read that, but if he does, that only came out this year, right?
Yeah, I think it came out kind of recently.
Yeah. So what I mean is like, when you first watched it, did you think Tony got murked, or was it left completely open for interpretation?
I felt it was like the optimist in me felt it was up for interpretation until I read that interview.
See, but like this thing is like, I don't know, the interview, it seemed like J.K. Rowling, where it's like years later, they're like, actually, Tony was gay. It's like, you know what I mean? Like, shit like that. I find that when it's so long after the original piece of work has been put out, I have trouble believing if that's someone's original intention. Mm-hmm. I think the original one was left open for interpretation. I also think the choice of song is almost too cheesy for it not to be left for open to interpretation because its journeys don't stop believing. So are you supposed to like not stop believing in Tony Soprano's ability to survive and skirt, you know, like we've seen him throughout six seasons, dodge, duck, dip, dive, and dodge all kinds of trouble.
Dodge, duck, tip, dive, and
dive. Who would win in a fight? Tony Soprano or Brian Cox's character from Dodgeball?
Yeah. Oh, wait, no, that's not. That's Rip Torn, dude.
Oh, Rip Torn.
What is this Rip Torn erasure on this? What the fuck?
You don't know any.
Cody, you know what we didn't catch in one of the episodes? I think the last one we recorded, you called Carmella Camilla.
Yeah, I actually did catch that. But I'm having trouble like correcting you because you always fuck up. Like you called Adriana Audriana.
Adriana. Yeah, I stay fucking up. Yeah. I'm never gonna get anyone.
You called Dr. Melby.
Dude, my friend Max called that. He texted me. He was like, dude, Cody doesn't know anyone's name. He called her Dr. Melby.
Yeah, dude, I don't know anyone's name.
But you also said Tony and the Doctor, and that's also pretty cool.
Yeah,
there. Tony and the Doctor.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll never.
So, Jake, so what are you saying? That it is open to interpretation?
Okay. What I say is originally, yes. And I still do, like, depending on how you take it. I think it's immensely meant to be open to interpretation. Even if it's like everything is set up for you to believe either direction. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That last scene is set up for you to be like, oh, he did get murdered, or oh, he didn't get murdered. Like, it, in that way,
that's
like,
what makes it so good.
It was, yeah, everything was planned for you to for us to have this conversation,
like shot by shot.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like this character, we're gonna put this character sitting at the bar stool. He might look like a hitman, you know what I mean? Or those right. two black guys that come in later, and we've seen throughout the show, they always like to hire black hitmen, so it makes it look outside. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. There's also could be an undercover FBI agent sitting in one of the booths.
Shit like that.
Like, it could be a sting. It doesn't have to be a whack.
There we
go.
I actually never even thought about that. You're right. That could be a sting right there where like a bunch of people at that diner, FBI agents, they're like, freeze, you're under arrest.
Yep. I don't think that's what it is, but it could be, you know, if we're going with the many interpretations theory, the many interpretations of Newark.
The multiverse of Newark, New Jersey. Newark 861 or whatever.
but let's not jump to that yet, because I think there's still some interesting things happening in this episode. We get Paulie. Do you think Paulie did something like ratted him out or set up a hit or something? Paulie seems pretty guilty in one part of this episode.
I think he's just an old man.
What do you mean?
I think he's just done. Like he's serving as much as he can to the family. Like he's like, even Tony even gives him captain of the Cifaretto crew.
Like, I believe he's superstitious.
And Tony's like, and Paulie's like, no, everyone who captained that crew dies early. Yeah. Gigi, right. Richie, April, like everyone just meets their end.
And it's true. It's true.
I don't think Paulie is a rat. I don't know.
I didn't think it until I saw it the second time. The first time I watched it, I didn't think this at all. This time, it's because there is the part. You're right, though. I agree. I think he is just like scared to take the position because of what you just said. But you know, again, if we want to interpret it different ways, because we don't know the real answer, like Paulie seems nervous, like, oh man, I just ratted Tony out and now he's offering me the position. You know what I mean? I feel like you could take it that way too.
That's true.
I get what you're saying, but
it's plausible. I just, for some reason, after seeing Paulie's like an OG, I feel like.
Yeah. And right. I think he's just like, I think at this point he's like, either I'm going to die or he like, I think just like, what, why would he be a rat? He ain't got no family. He ain't got, all he has is the mob.
That's true. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cody's right. He does lose his mom in this season.
Maybe not a rat to the FBI. So maybe I mean,
because we've already seen him play with, you know, play the other side with Johnny Sack in those earlier seasons.
Exactly. Yeah.
Maybe to survive the war, he made a deal with New York. It was like, I'll give Tony up if you guys leave me out of it.
Right. Because the crew's getting whacked left and right.
The crews are getting whacked left and right. Yeah.
We get Adriana Cat. It's not Adriana. Exactly.
But you know, so I was watching it and I was thinking about the Adriana theory. And I don't know if it holds up more than it being Christopher, only because Paulie hates it. And he's about to hit it with the broom before Tony comes in.
Right.
And it's like, he didn't feel that way towards Adriana.
That's true. And they call it a he.
And they call it a he, yeah.
Yeah, I want to think it's more Adriana, though, because it's staring at the picture of Christopher, you know, it's just like misses him in some way.
Yeah.
I mean, the other thing is that Christopher dies maybe a few episodes before this. I don't remember what episode Christopher dies in, but...
He dies like, yeah, like five episodes before this.
Okay. And Adriana dies like a season before. So we're even almost two seasons before. And yeah. And they say, where'd that cat come from? And they're like, I don't know. It just showed up after the snowstorm. And if Christopher recently died, you know, I could see how it's, you know, it doesn't matter who it is at the end of the day. Like, it's just like a cat. It's just a fucking cat. With us. Yeah. Like, it can mean absolutely nothing. It's just like, it's David Chase playing with our mind. Like, he wants us to feel like Paulie. Like,
I like that the last two episodes, Anthony's just like, I'm going to be the crazy theory dude. Just,
yeah.
But no, I don't really care. If anything, it just kind of like gives a kind of sense of like almost magic to the Sopranos lore. You know what I mean? Kind of like how we talked about, do ghosts exist in the Sopranos universe? Yeah. You know what right. I mean?
Well, like, yeah, like, I don't know. It's because then we're like, oh, 3 o'clock and that dude walks on Tony's 3 o'clock. It's like, is it? Mm-hmm. I don't know. Maybe it's not even as deep as we're making it out to be. And yet that might be even the genius of David Chase.
Well, if you want to talk about things David Chase said, he's like, you know, back in the day, he never said what it was, right? He didn't say what the ending was, but he did say the answer's there. There is an answer and it's there, but I'm not.
That sounds like so ambiguous and just auspicious that it's meant to.
I mean, I think a lot of, you know, creators, directors, like they'll say, you know, it's like, I'm not going to tell you exactly what the thing I made is about. Like, it's just, it speaks for itself. David Chase would say the answer's there. Like, I can't tell you what it is. If the answer isn't there, then he didn't do his job right. According to him, like, I'm not saying this is the answer. It's still up to interpretation, right? It's just an ambiguous ending.
So that's all he said? He didn't say,
I don't know. You're saying he said this new thing recently. So I didn't hear this.
Maybe he didn't. Maybe, I don't know. I feel like I saw him say that he confirmed that Tony's, you know what I'm saying? I think, pretty sure.
I don't know, I haven't seen it, but I don't trust it.
Okay, well, if I'll look for it afterwards and see if I can show you.
Yeah.
Wake up, Cody.
Yeah, you're quiet this episode.
You wake up. I was just...
I'm up.
Yeah, I definitely lead the Sopranos dialogue, my dude.
Well, so I just want to bring up my thing that happened in the episode that I want to bring up.
Okay.
Is I loved the way Phil Leotardo went out.
Yeah. That was an awesome kill.
Yep. It was overkill.
Also, what a satisfying death. What a satisfying death. He was a schmuck towards the end.
Yeah.
Great character, but like, you hated him. You're like, fuck.
Hated him. He had no redeeming qualities.
Yeah. He like, fuck his dead brother, too. I'm glad he got killed for no reason.
Yeah, I do not like the Leotardos.
Yeah. Yeah. Dude, yeah, when the tire runs over his head and just,
oof.
And that one dude throws up. It's like, what?
The baby's in the car.
The baby's in the car. Also, that woman could have just got in and break the car. It wasn't even moving fast. She was like, stop my car.
Yeah,
I was laughing when the kid threw up, though. It's like such a morbid scene, but
that was like the comic relief of the episode.
Yeah, it was his death.
Yeah, dude, it was so funny.
Oh, and man. You know what? He got killed from the side out of nowhere.
Pop.
Yeah.
You know, boom.
That's true. You just see the dude's gun come into frame. It's like,
yep.
Walter, that one new dude of the crew for some reason. This is the episode where Paulie goes, what kind of name is Walter for Italian?
Oh, yeah. He's like, I was named after Bobby Darin. Yeah, Bobby something. Darin. Yeah.
Mr. Walt, because something, whatever his last name was.
Yeah.
Paulie, what a dick.
Dude, Paulie's hilarious as always at Bobby's funeral and stuff.
Oh, that's great. I love that scene. I feel bad. So bad for Bobby.
Yeah, dude. Heartbreak City.
Yeah, Bobby's a good guy. R.I.P. Bobby.
The GOAT.
It's funny because I just watched Home Movies and, you know, he's a big character in that episode.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's sad. So it all goes downhill for Bobby.
Yep. Never should have raised his hand to the boss.
It's weird. Like, Janice and Tony talk about that scene in this episode. And Janice is like laughing about it. He's like, oh, remember when he, you know, put his hand up to me when I made that joke? And she's like, yeah. Like, well, yeah. Okay. Like, that was such a big deal. And she's just like, ah, yeah.
It wasn't to them, though. They've already seen such hurtful shit in their lives growing up.
Right.
Sopranos are morbid people.
And Janice is basically Livia now.
Oh, yeah. That's what I like about that scene with her talking to Tony in the end. She says shit that, like, their mom said.
Yeah, exactly.
She says, in regards to, like, Bobby's daughter, Sophia, she's like, Dominica is my daughter. She's like, and she's very much in love with her older sister. She's like, you're crazy if you think I'm going to let Sophie leave this house. And Tony even says, he's like, was that one a joke? Because that one even got by me.
Yeah.
Like, she's completely just Livia now, you know?
Yeah.
Yep, exactly.
She's going to ruin another few kids' lives. Dude, what happens to Bobby Bacala Jr.? What's his story?
Mm.
Does he clap back?
Hey, maybe Meadow recruits him for her.
Oh, shit.
For her crew.
Dude, this is sick. Like the Young Avengers, but with the Sopranos kids.
I mean, and there you said right there, we got Nika, Ray Janice's daughter. She's going to want to be part of this. Dude,
Walter will be in the crew.
Walter. Yeah. He's still alive.
Right.
Who did we say was going to be her concierge?
Oh, Consigliere?
Furio. He's coming back.
Furio comes back from Italy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not in this episode, guys. In our
Yeah, none of this. This is all fan fiction. What else happens this episode?
Fucking AJ in this episode is
AJ like, just wilding out.
Yeah, with the blowing up that car.
Yep.
While listening to Bob Dylan, right?
Yeah, the dumbest thing you could ever do.
Seriously, and I love when he turns to that girl. He's like, "Oh man," he's like, "they're talking about like such deep shit." It's like, shut up, dude.
Yeah.
That's always how I felt about Bob Dylan, so it makes sense that that's how I feel about AJ.
Yeah.
I always hated people that are like, dude, Bob Dylan's like, whatever, man. I can do that.
Dude, I like Bob Dylan a lot.
I like music, but I don't think he's saying anything prolific, honestly.
Oh yeah, same.
People hype the fuck out of him.
Oh yeah. I'm more of a Neil Young guy myself.
I'm more of a Journey guy. Steve Perry might be.
Okay. So let's get it. Oh, wait. One more thing. So one more thing that happened. The final scene with Uncle June.
Very sad.
Yeah. Uncle June doesn't even remember Tony.
I just like this, the part where Tony's like, he's like, this thing of ours. And Uncle Junior, that's the only thing he slightly remembers. He goes, I was a part of that. He's like, you and Johnny ran North Jersey. And then Uncle Junior goes, that's nice.
Yeah. Like,
and just looks off into the window at the birds.
Uncle Junior pretty much gets the best ending for a mobster. He doesn't go to jail and he doesn't get whacked.
No, he just loses his mind and memory.
Yeah. So he survives. Yeah. He just doesn't have it.
Dude, I think actually the winner of Sopranos is Patsy Parisi.
Of the family, you mean of the family? Monsters.
Yeah, because even if Tony does A, get killed or indicted, like Patsy's still on there on the street, he could take the reins.
Ooh, could Patsy have called a hit on Tony?
Because remember, ooh, shit, as like ultimate revenge for his brother.
Oh, yeah.
And we do actually, dude, okay. So we do see in this episode, Tony and Carmella meet up with Patsy and his wife. They're having dinner because their kids are pretty much about to be engaged. Remember?
Uh-huh.
And if you can even go back and watch it after this just to see, like, Patsy does give like Tony a look when he gives him a drink. Remember?
Yes, I remember this. Yeah. And I didn't think of this. This is one of those things that are coming to me just now. And it's like, wait a minute, this kind of makes sense.
Dude, Carmella says, Tony, Patsy needs a refill. And Patsy's like, no, I got it. He's like, Tony. Tony's like, no, cool. And then like he grabs the glass from Patsy and Patsy just gives him, like the camera focuses on the look that he gives.
Yeah, no, I do remember this. And then even like his wife is like trying to tell a joke and she can't tell a joke at all.
Yeah, he's like bad at telling jokes or whatever.
Dude, what if we, because of this, what if Patsy is low-key the villain of season one of Meadowlands?
Yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah.
But she doesn't know it. She doesn't know it.
Yeah.
And they get married. No.
Yeah, at the end of the season, she has to kill Patsy and keep it from her husband.
Ooh, I like that. Dude, we have to write the script of Meadowlands.
We really do. I mean, now we have to.
We're just coming up with too much shit to not write it.
Wait, I was definitely taking notes the other day after we talked. I was like, wait a minute, I'm down to
honestly work on that as a fun, like, just for shits and it's always going to be stupid, but like, it'll be funny as fuck. Ooh, dude, what if we perform that and we use
we could do that. Now, who else has to be a character in Meadowlands, I thought? Even if it's just for like an episode or an arc or a season. Eugene has a daughter.
Eugene has a daughter. There's a lot of people have kids. Big Pussy has kids. Vito Spatafor has kids.
Yes. Vito's son. Yeah.
Shout out to Vito, R.I.P.
There's a lot of next generation Soprano kids that could pop in and out.
Shit. Like the Teen Titans of Sopranos. Yeah.
Exactly. Plus, they could, you still have like all of those people that were in the crew, like in the house, like what's his name with the soul patch and stuff like that. And that bald dude.
Yeah. There's the big bald guy. Yeah. That's what I mean. There's like those auxiliary, like family members. They're clearly not made. They're just like, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's the other dude. There's Walt. We said, there's like a few of them, honestly.
The dude that you said says like Tony had gout yesterday. What's that guy's name?
Benny Fazio.
Benny. Yeah. Yep. He's alive.
Who is a made guy? So yeah. Like, yeah, he's alive. You know what?
They could take Silvio out of a coma.
Oh, shit.
Right?
Maybe he can't handle the pressure of being a boss. So what would be the point?
At least he could like be a character. That's all I'm saying. Like he could somehow survive and still be like an old man. Like that's like the junior of the show.
Yeah, like what, hobbling around on a cane. No,
you know, it would be a sick ending. Like Sylvia like wakes up. Like he legit, like he's getting out of his coma. And, like you see, like the camera's all blurry, and he like looks to, and the FBI is there, and like Sylvia Dante, you're under arrest, and like arrest him for all the shit that they've been building on for years. So like his ending sucks. He survives a coma just to get arrested by the FBI.
So then he's like the Ray Liotta in Many Saints of Newark character. He's in jail and Meadow goes to him for advice.
Exactly.
Because we got to tie in Many Saints.
Oh God. Dude.
No, that's not canon with the Meadowlands.
That's true. I agree. It's not canon with Meadowlands.
Okay, it's not compatible.
Yeah, we're strictly like
if Disney can erase Star Wars books as canon, we can erase the Meadowlands as canon Many Saints.
Yeah. I agree with that. I agree with that.
So it is said.
That's from HQ, by the way.
Yeah. Right down from HQ. They're sending a lot of stuff today.
We're getting a lot of memos from HQ.
But something else about what they say. Okay, so AJ, right? He says in the future he wants to be a pilot for Donald Trump.
Trump, yeah.
We could actually do that. Like, yeah,
he pilots Air Force One.
Yeah. Shit,
that'd be sick.
AJ Soprano.
And then Meadow goes all the way up to the fucking White House.
Yeah.
This is insane. Meadow from president.
Luther becoming president.
Yeah. Or Kingpin becoming mayor of New York.
or you could have Meadow become like governor of New Jersey. She takes on Chris Christie.
Oh shit.
Oh, you know what's actually really good in this episode? It's actually during the scene where Patsy and his wife and his son are there. You know, they're all having coffee, whatever. And dude, if you watch it, did you notice the way Meadow's boyfriend like dotes on her? And he even says, don't sell yourself short or don't devalue yourself when they're talking about possibly getting an offer a job from the law firm.
Right.
You see Carmella look at him and she looks so sad. Like she's never had that and she's never
gonna
have
that. Yeah. Ooh, something similar when she's talking to Meadow's friend who comes back. We haven't seen her since like an earlier season.
Yeah. From the second season. Yeah.
Yeah. And she's like, oh, she's in her second year at med school. And Carmella does the same thing.
Same thing. She gets visibly disappointed because Meadow is not in med school.
No, I don't think it's that. I think it's what you just said. I think Carmella, and it happens in a lot of episodes when someone is successful because of them. They're independent women. She does not like it because she can never be that. She always relies on Tony.
Yep.
It's sad. Yeah. That's like Carmella's like.
Carmella's kind of a sad character.
Yeah, she is.
Yeah, she's a powerful woman, but only because of Tony.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
it's not a fault of hers. That's just the truth.
Yes.
Yeah.
She sees it as a fault for sure. She wants the same things that she's seeing, but it's just like she always, even with her house, without Tony, it doesn't happen.
Carmella's tale is kind of like a warning of like taking the easy way rather than working. You know what I mean? Look at the house that she built. She tried to have her dad do it. Like she wanted the success, but she didn't. She wanted it handed to her by Tony. Like, you know what I mean? Like she didn't know how to get it on her own,
even though she tried for sure.
Yeah,
she does go to college. They mentioned the show that she drops out of Montclair State.
Oh, really?
She
drops out.
Yeah, she drops out. Meadow even insults her one time when they're out together. Meadow's like, maybe I can drop out of Montclair State like you did. And then Carmella's like, watch your mouth. But yeah, no, like, you're right. It's just sad that like she sees in these women, even her own daughter, like women who are independent, and she'll always be a mafia wife. And we've seen in this show what happens to a gangster's wife when they either get arrested or die. They always end up like poor. You know what I mean? Like the family doesn't really take care of one another when all is said and done.
No, they don't.
And so, like, Tony has been having to low-key build up a pile of money for this very moment if he does get arrested and or dies for Carmella to live off for the rest of her life.
And he still
can't. Bump and Sarah, who pretty much had to join the mafia to even afford to, like, live. You know what I mean?
True. But then she does make it on her own because she has the body shot. I know, but
she's
shot.
An earner now. She's an earner now for Tony.
Right.
You can pop her now.
Yeah. It's crazy though that Tony, like, he goes to talk to Uncle Junior, he still doesn't know where his money is.
Yeah.
Like, Uncle Junior has money that they can never find. You think he doesn't? Like, you think it's just like,
oh, he might be no just crazy.
There might be no money at all.
There's probably that's the thing, there's probably no money at all.
Yeah. He's probably just rambling about it because maybe at one point decades ago there was money. Yeah. You know what I mean? But a lot's happened since then.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's true.
All right, should we talk about the final scene?
Yeah, let's do it.
The final
scene. Cody's ready to wrap it up. Cody's ready to go to sleep.
Cody, what's up with you, man? Why are you so low energy, bro?
I'm on edibles.
Okay. Why didn't you say so?
Yeah.
I didn't realize it until just now. I was like, why am I this way?
Yeah.
I did eat a gummy. Nice.
Oh, one more thing. Paulie, like, confesses to Tony, he's like, one time at the Bing, I saw the Virgin Mary. And he jokes about it, and Paulie gets mad. He's like, I confess, like, my deepest secret, and you laugh at it. But then they start talking about that. But if you go, there's an episode where Paulie's in the club, and he does see the Virgin Mary. It's really creepy. It's a really creepy scene.
It is a creepy scene. I remember that completely.
I had to go back and watch that episode, and it's like, you see her in the mirror, and Paulie notices her, and then you see her like float for a second, and it's like,
it's that weird rock and roll music.
Yeah.
Paulie Walnuts.
Paulie Walnuts.
R.I.P. Tony Sirico.
Yeah, R.I.P. The GOAT.
All right, so the last scene, it's Tony, Carmella, and AJ. They're sitting at a diner, eating onion rings, just talking about life. And you see a bunch of characters come in, all well-placed. There's kids eating. There's a couple over there. And then he picks the Journey's Don't Stop Believin'.
Yep.
You know, like, why that song? Why that song if you're not supposed to stop believing in Tony Soprano?
Are you supposed to believe he survived? Is that what you mean?
I don't... I don't know. That he survived, you just believe in him.
Yeah, I think it's more... This scene in particular... the only other like mob movie related movie I've ever seen that's made me feel this way was that one with Brad Pitt. You know what I'm talking about? Ray Liotta.
Killing Them Softly.
Yeah.
That's a good movie. It's not as good as Brad. Yeah.
Not even close. I'm not saying it was, but I'm saying like the ending has kind of almost a similar feel as the ending. I mean, I know it would be the other way around because Sopranos came way first, but you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They have kind of similar vibes. It feels like, like very much a criticism of like America today. You know what I mean? And like just the way AJ's been, that's been like AJ's whole plot line this episode, you know, and they're complaining about it, but also very optimistic. You know what I mean? And
that's true.
And the conversation they have almost feels like kind of like a final conversation. You know what I mean? Like the way AJ's like, hey, you got to remember the good times and stuff like that, you know?
But that's actually a callback to season one finale.
Exactly.
Yeah, it is.
They're having a very similar dinner scene, but during Meadow's the there.
Rainstorm.
Yep. Yeah. They're together.
Yeah.
So do you think that maybe like they became too optimistic too late in life? Like, do we believe that only Tony Soprano died or Carmella and AJ, whether it's accidentally or not, joined that? You know,
I mean, it's definitely potential. Hopefully, AJ, if any of them,
right? Definitely. Also, fuck AJ for fucking up so bad, and then he gets a producer job.
Hey, man, that happened to me, dog. So, how do you think I got the bachelor job?
But you're not AJ.
No, but I fucked up bad, and then someone just got me a job being a producer. So, I'm not going to knock that. That's how you make it.
Wow. So Jake is the AJ of Comics and Chronic confirmed.
You know what I did, Anthony? I did something that all people are capable of doing, but very few don't. And that's I put myself up by my bootstraps.
Hell yeah, dude.
Jake was made in America.
Yeah. I want to be in America. Why do you think this episode was called Made in America? We always talk about the titles of their episodes.
Well, I think it's connected to Don't Stop Believing. I think it's just like the whole, like, just a small like, town.
This is the American experience.
Yeah, and like Tony did make it. Even if he dies right then, he made it. And he's a made man. Maybe that's the meaning too, right? Like he's made in America. I don't know how heavy-handed David Chase is being with that, but the fact that Don't Stop Believing, I think like, it's such an
American song.
I guess you could say that. Yeah, it's definitely an American song, but it's not like a deep song. You know exactly what Don't Stop Believing is about. Don't stop believing, you know, like
dude, just
that's the American dream. Keep believing, even if you're about to get shot in the head. He keeps believing up until that moment.
So do we think he dies? Do you think he dies? Like, what's your guy's
hell opinion? Yes. Hell yes, he's dead.
Yeah,
he's dead, huh? Interesting.
I think he gets waxed by the guy in the members only jacket specifically.
A callback
to that first episode of season six.
What if it's Eugene's brother who kills?
Ooh, I could believe that. Like I could see that he's like a relative of Eugene's.
Yeah.
Maybe that's Eugene's actual jacket he's wearing. It's just like, this is for Eugene.
Yeah. Shit.
Or could he be hired by Eugene's wife? She has beef
that's
now.
That's true. We do see in that episode that she like low-key hates Tony Soprano.
But so many people hate Tony. That's the thing. It could be anyone who put a whack on him.
Yeah, really? It could be New York. It could be New York.
It could be Patsy.
Russians. We've seen there be Russians. You know?
It could seriously be a lot of people. It could be Melfi. Melfi put the hit on him.
Yeah, it could be.
Melfi's husband.
Oh, shit.
The list goes on and on.
The list does go on, honestly.
Tony's reach, his dark reach, ruined a lot of lives. It could be the woman that burnt herself.
Oh, Valentina.
Valentina. It could be Valentina, right?
Oh, shit.
Could it be Adriana's mom?
Oh. Adriana's mom.
Who shot Mr. Burns? We need to find out.
Yeah, I like Adriana's mom.
Adriana's mom's killer.
Dude, yeah, could be Paulie.
It could be Paulie.
Could be Paulie, like we said, yeah.
You've seen Tony Soprano, no matter what else you've seen, you've seen him be bad for six seasons straight. So it's like, sooner or later, he's going to get his comeuppance.
Yeah.
I think also, and we talked about this in the last episode, specifically, Anthony, you mentioned when he was eating at the sushi restaurant, and I just mentioned gout in this one. He's also unhealthy. So he has legal problems, he has literal health problems, and he could be killed by anybody.
Yeah.
The fact of the matter is, like, no matter what happens, he's on the decline.
Yeah.
Another thing to add to your health problems theory, when he sees AJ running, he's like, oh, I'm going to start soon too.
Yeah, right. Yeah, no, he does say that.
We've all been there.
Like, it's like, yeah, I say that every day.
Yeah, I don't. I don't know. He's dead, man. That guy gets popped. Right in the back of the
Okay, so we can agree there. Do you think AJ and Carmella dies with him?
I don't see any reason why they would.
I think I agree with that. And yet, I can almost argue otherwise.
Go for it. I want
to
hear this.
And this is when you start to get into like the themes and the meta shit of Sopranos.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, can we go down the rabbit hole for this?
Because I go down the rabbit hole. All right. So, well, one thing that's like throughout the entire show of Sopranos are the religious themes, specifically with Carmella and her Catholicism. We see from literally the first season to now her trying to rationalize her relationship with Tony. And she clearly feels guilty of it. She always talks to the church about, you know, enabling Tony. She goes to that one Jewish psychiatrist who tells him to to leave him. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, if you were to go off the religious reasons, both Carmella and AJ would die too, because AJ committed suicide, which in Catholicism is a sin. He would go to hell. You know what I mean? Meadow is also the only person not yet there. You could take it as that she's being spared this death for whatever reason. And what she walks in on is a massacre. Meadow, throughout the show, is out of all of them, AJ, Carmella, and Tony, is easily the best human being.
Easily.
And that maybe she's the only one that deserves a chance to live a life and do anything
good. Or to take the mantle and avenge family.
Exactly.
I heard a theory that Meadow is Tony's guardian angel. So the reason he dies is because Meadow's not there. You could go back to, I think, season one, where they're on that road trip and that guy's about to snipe Tony, but Meadow's there and it stops the guy.
But in that same season, first season, Uncle Junior hires the two black guys to kill Tony when they shoot him, and Meadow's not there and he still survives.
Right, but Meadow's not there and they shoot him. He's not in danger when Meadow's around. That's not my theory. I just present theories. Anytime I present a theory, I'm saying this is not my theory. Okay. Sitting here like, what are these Sopranos? You know,
I'm just saying that one's not strong enough for me.
Yeah, but something you said to me when I first watched the finale and you pointed it out to me, the thing about Meadow parallel parking.
It takes her three tries to get it right.
Right. And why is that significant though?
Because Tony's been tried to be murked three times throughout the season. Or this might be the third time. The first time is when Uncle Junior hires the black guys. The second time is when Uncle Junior shoots him in the beginning of the season six.
Yeah.
And one might argue that this is the third and final time.
Also, isn't 3 o'clock?
The third and final time, 3 o'clock. He's at his three. There's only three people sitting in that booth, Carmella, AJ, and Tony. Boom.
There's three Boy Scouts that you see in a booth in the back.
They die. Meadow lives. I think Carmella and AJ, not even necessarily on purpose, but just for whatever reason, through crossfire, ricochet, I think they die. I think Meadow walks in on a massacre.
Okay, here's something that's happening in that scene. Let me go down the rabbit hole for a second and say...
Is this your own original rabbit hole?
No, of course not. of course not. Because when I first watched the finale, I just was like soaking it in and you know... Ooh.
Soaking, I like that word.
Hey, yeah. So I was, and this time I
was, hell yeah, brother.
Hey, if you're not soaking by the end of the Sopranos finale, you're not a human. Like, just watch some, I don't know. You can't watch TV, I guess.
All right, what's this theory?
Okay, so Tony walks in, right? In the top left, you see a tiger. Now, tiger cats are bad in the Sopranos. Or they're a bad omen because, you know, Paulie's talking about...
Wait, I have to sit, otherwise I'm going to forget it. Okay, I agree. I like where you're going with the cats are bad omens, because one might argue that birds, such as the ducks or the crow that sees Christopher when he's getting made, are good omens for them.
Yeah. That's interesting too.
There you go. Go back.
Okay, so that it's just there when he walks in, right? And then...
Wait, this is in the diner?
Yeah, this is in the diner. Okay. This is what I'm saying. Just in the final scene alone.
There's a picture up there of a tiger?
Of a tiger, yeah.
Oh, shit. I didn't see that.
Also, you get to see the guy in the members only jacket get up to go to the bathroom. Like, they show you. They always focus on that guy. Yeah. That's why I feel like, of course, he's important. They're always, unless it's a swerve for whatever reason, but he goes to the bathroom, right? And the Godfather, Michael Corleone, goes to the bathroom to grab a gun.
Gets the gun.
And of course we find out, and there's a scene where AJ's like crying to Tony and he's like, that's your favorite scene in The Godfather. Every time it comes on, you have to let me know. Like we like know
the movies, AJ.
Yeah. But it's, you know, it's kind of funny that's like Tony's favorite scene, and something similar could be happening to him. But then, okay. So he's every time the bell rings, right? For the door on the diner, it cuts to Tony's face.
Yeah. We see Tony look up every time someone comes in.
Right. Okay. Rather, we see what Tony sees. That's one way of looking at it, I guess.
Okay.
So it rings, looks up, ring. When Meadow was supposed to walk in, when it cuts to Tony, instead of cuts to black, what we should see is Meadow. But if we're seeing what Tony's seeing, then we see nothing. Silence, which we know, we've talked about this, what Bobby says, like you don't hear, it's just like, you don't hear the guy coming and it just ends. Something like that. I don't remember the line. And then we know Silvio doesn't hear anything when someone gets shot right in front of him, doesn't even see it. It doesn't even register in his mind that someone's getting shot in front of him, even though blood splatters on him. You know, it's just like it takes a second. And then, like we said before, Phil Leotardo, he just gets whacked out of nowhere. He doesn't see that coming. He's talking to his wife, talking to the babies. So it just, to me, that makes so much sense. Cut to black. Tony's dead.
Yeah, for sure.
That, I could also argue another reason for why AJ and Carmella also die. What if that dude in the member's only jacket is not the only shooter there?
Mm.
So going back, because the camera also does focus on the two black guys who come in.
Right, it does.
We've seen throughout the show them usually it's two black guys as hitmen, right? Junior hires two black guys in the first season. Christopher hires the two black guys originally to go kill Carmine Libertazzi, but then Tony makes them switch and they end up killing the black guys. So
right.
We know that. So what if, and based on where you see them enter the diner, they wouldn't have walked yet to where Tony's table is. So if they were to pull out and start shooting Tony from that distance, they could hit AJ and Carmella by accident because they would be in the line of fire.
I could see that happening.
And then you have that members only dude also come out. What if like,
They have a shootout with each other.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Like, what if it's just like a full-on massacre?
Yeah.
And there could be FBI. 20
people die at this diner, including FBI agents, whatever. Like, you know what I mean? I'm not even saying that it's coordinated for the members only dude and the black dudes to be there at the same time. Like, what if Tony's luck just literally ends there at that scene?
Yeah. Because, I mean, he's been so fucking lucky.
So lucky. And finally, everything is converged at once to, like, take him down. The FBI, if you want to go with the FBI theory, that they're low-key there, they're about to sting operation arrest him, like, everything is just, you know, met its demise.
Yeah. Either way, Tony's story's done. That's it.
Yes.
We don't see it anymore.
Remember, the Sopranos, it's plural. Meadow takes the reins, starts the whole new family.
Boom.
Yeah.
Meadow sees this happening.
Yeah. She's like, I know what I have to do.
It changes her. It changes her.
So how many Joe Peasy's we giving this?
Come on.
Six.
This is the greatest television finale in all of television.
Oh, snap.
I'd argue the same.
There was a time where I wouldn't argue that. And now, I don't know. I also really like the Wire series finale. But
I haven't seen it, so I can't say that. Yeah, maybe that would change my mind then. Is it that it's on par?
No, I mean, it's completely different than Sopranos. But yeah, it's a very satisfying ending. So yeah, I would give this episode a 6. But are you going to give season 6B a 6?
No.
Yeah, no. Ooh. See, this episode gets a 6. Easily.
Episode easy 6. Season, I'm not going to give it too terrible a rating. Maybe like 5.5.
It's fair. I'd give it like a 5 something also. Not bad, but just not as good. But this episode almost cinches it, you know?
Yeah, I would even say I would normally give it like a 5, even like a 5.0 or a 5.2. But this episode brings it up to a 5.5.
Nice. I also watched Sopranos Home Movies the other night.
Yeah.
And I really like that episode a lot.
Yeah. Hopefully we get to record that episode. If we don't, maybe we just record a bonus one for ourselves. Who gives a fuck?
Shit.
Yeah, maybe we just
a bonus episode for Bobby Bacala. Bonus Bobby
bonus Bobby episode.
BB.
But I kind of feel like Cody, like this episode weighs heavily on the score of the season, but like if I could take this episode out, even though Sopranos Home Movies is a banger, it's just like getting into Sopranos, I didn't know what to expect. And then it kind of turns everything on its head in a great way. And it becomes a show that like is familiar. And like by this season, it feels very mob heavy in a way, like about people getting hit all the time and getting, and you know, like the mob wars, basically. I feel like that takes over the story in a way that's, it's cool, but it's like, I always love the family drama stuff. And like, that's what I love about the finale. Like they're back to sitting down, having dinner together. It's like, it is a cool moment. You want them to have a happy ending. You know, I wish that was my first, that was my first reaction to the finale, right? Like, I wasn't thinking about these theories and shit. Like, what I was thinking was, I was like, oh man, he can't be gone, right? Like, Meadow goes in and that's just it. That's just the end. Like, you know, he's smiling after that or something. But like, I just don't think that could be the end for this guy, you know? But you this don't. But this season, I don't know. I don't know. What were you going to say, Jake?
I forgot.
Oh, man.
But so, wait, Anthony, you don't think he's dead?
No, I do think he's dead. I'm just saying when I first watched it, I was hoping. Like, you know, it's just how I feel watching the characters. Like, here's what I heard David Chase say. Or it's something he said in an interview. He said he didn't like how people, like, were starting to see, like, that they were tuning in to see Tony, like, kill somebody. They were like, you know, you shouldn't be rooting for Tony. Like, Tony's not a good person. Yeah. But he becomes that because James Gandolfini is just fucking great. It's just good TV. You can't help but root for him, you know? So I think something David Chase was talking about was like not giving people the satisfaction, you know? Like just cutting it there. Just, you know, you don't get to see what happens to Tony, whether or not the FBI got him or whoever killed him or whatnot.
The Illuminati took out Tony.
There you go.
Ooh, he had too much power.
Yeah. So Dr. Richards and Dr. Strange.
Oh, that Illuminati?
That Illuminati, yeah.
Oh, you mean like Jay-Z Illuminati?
Oh, shit. Who would win, Jay-Z or Tony Soprano?
Jay, man.
Really?
Yeah. Hove? Are you kidding
Rockefeller
me?
Versus the Sopranos?
Yeah. Hove probably has the whole five families in New York behind him, you know?
That's true. So I had a question. Now that we've done Sopranos Summer, what do you guys feel about the episodes I chose?
Ooh.
Mm.
Interesting. Because
each one was different from the next and almost different from their respective seasons.
Yeah. No, I thought it was a great selection. I think there was like only one where none of them were bad. I might have picked a couple differently, but I'm also not as knowledgeable as you are. So I don't know. It was great, though. I loved every single episode we watched.
Yeah, no, I thought every episode you picked was great. There are just so many great ones, and there's multiple great ones in each season. So like, yeah, it's impossible that we were going to, you know, hit every great one. I think going through the seasons, I definitely have some ideas if we did more Soprano Summer of which episodes I'd want to talk about.
Every summer now. Next summer, let's pick a whole tradition. New bunch of episodes. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Season two.
Yeah, season two.
Soprano Summer.
We got to do it.
Oh, you know what we should have called this? Soprano Summer 2000 and Gabba.